When we reason together. When we reason in public. I mean, maybe not on a jumbotron at the middle of a football stadium, maybe not that public, maybe not on television, maybe not that public, but we reason with one another. So in fact, we're engaged in a conversation right now that itself is a form of reasoning, because we're trying to figure out how to understand the world, and we're doing that collaboratively. Your questions, my responses, your responses to my responses, and so on, are kind of a little dialectical interplay that helps us refine our thoughts, to calibrate them to the subject, to erect structures around them so that we can see how they fit with one another. And all of that takes place typically in a dialogue or a more extensive discussion. When we look at it as a real social problem, we always find that there's a communication part of it that looms very, very large. And communication helps us to calibrate our thinking with one another so that I come to understand what you're thinking by dint of talking with you a lot. So the more we talk together, the more I understand how your brain works, as it were, how you reason, you know, what your values are, what your kind of theoretical take on the human condition is or the natural world is.
Well, with science, science is quite new in some sense. People have known all sorts of things about the world going back thousands of years, but science tries to systematize this knowledge and make it more coherent. But science does something else. It speculates. A whole lot of data is gathered by someone who's particularly interested in, say, the movement of the planets in the night sky. And they make up stories about how this happens. Nowadays, of course, many of the stories are highly mathematical stories about how this happens. Before they claim to know anything, they have to really put their speculations through a series of tests. And if the speculation survives a series of standard tests, or any test that anyone might think, and the speculation survives all those, then it might be promoted to knowledge, because it survives all the tests. And the person can say, well, this is how I know. I've got all this data. There's a pattern in this data. It's a mathematical pattern. And I've checked this out, looked for exceptions, the exceptions that disprove the rule. And then if they just can't find anything, then they'll promote it to knowledge. And in the culture of science, they'll try to get this confirmed as knowledge by publishing it and talking to all their colleagues about it. And their colleagues will do something that philosophers do. They try to test this knowledge by refutation. Ah, I think I've got a counterexample. I've got a way of showing that it isn't knowledge because it's not true in every case. Now, this goes on all the time in science. So when someone says the science of X is fixed, they've made a serious mistake about science.
Science can answer questions that involve something that you can observe, and or an effect, something that has an effect that you can observe, and it's a consistent effect, a reproducible effect. You have to be able to measure that. So there has to be some kind of equipment or method that you can use to measure it. And actually, this is where a lot of our advances in science come from, is improvements in technology that allow us to measure things that we couldn't measure. I mean, the Higgs boson, for example, 20 years ago, you couldn't have measured the ripples in space that are involved and associated with the Higgs boson. But now you can. MRI machines, another example. MRI machines actually look at the water content in your body. 40 years ago, we didn't have the technology to do an MRI. So we can now observe things that are very different to what we could observe 20, 30 years ago. What questions can we not answer? Questions that involve faith, questions where you have to believe something and there's nothing that you can test. Questions where if you have a doubt, there's nothing that you can do to address that doubt.